All right, guys. Welcome to Coach's Corner. This episode, we need a new intro. That intro is like 3 years old. We need something new and fresh and a proper video like our other intros and outros and things like that. So today we're going to be continuing on with our Guild app series. Last week we interviewed Ash, as a potential, really as a mock interview of her potential applicant. I showed you guys lots of different questions that guilds may ask during the interview process, some class related, some a little bit more social. And now the app process has continued. So now Ashtanga has actually, we're going to pretend he's gone through a number of raids with us. He's done some testing. And this is at the point where, we do these almost nightly debriefs with our apps. So, you do your farm night, your once a week Hellfire Citadel with the guild, and then we debrief on how you did, mechanics, your numbers, that kind of stuff, why you chose certain spells in certain situations, how familiar you are with strats. And that's something that all of the mentors, and we assign two mentors to the guild, to each applicant, to make sure, they're getting along with everybody. They're fitting in well, they're having fun, they're not, too scared of Sparty. When Sparty yells at them, they know that it's not personal and I don't hate them, but it's really to make them a better player, and it's because they messed up. We want them to sort of mold into that good raider that we're looking for. So what we're going to do is, I've done this again on a previous YouTube video, we're going to be using Ash. Let's say he's my mentor, I'm his mentor, and he's my applicant, and I'm trying to mold him into this decent player, hopefully. And if volume is okay, let me know. If it's not okay, then I'll, make some adjustments here as well. Okay, so we'll get going. All right, Ash, ready?
Always.
Okay, so, this was, your first couple raids with Death Jesters. How did you find them? And you've done some PTR testing with us already. So how did you find the raids?
I thought they were more or less what I expected in terms of the environment. At least, I was surprised when I was allowed to actually come in raid, but it was, like I said, what I expected, and I thought it did well enough.
Okay, so on which of the encounters, so are you referring more to the testing?
Sure.
Okay, so the testing. So which of the encounters do you think you did, pretty well on?
I think I did pretty good on Elisande and Tyke, Croesus as well.
Do you have logs ready for those?
Yeah, I have Elisande and Tyke.
Okay, do you want to look them to me? Look at them together.
Yeah.
Okay, one sec here. Are these the logs I linked you earlier?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay, I thought you had other specific logs. That's fine. I got these already up as well. Okay, so, yeah, this is the healing breakdown with you and me, right, on Grand Magistrix? Mm-hmm. Okay, so why do you think you did specifically well on this encounter?
I would say I was getting more to the pattern of the strategy that DJs does with having the recursive and expedient on opposite sides of the boss, keeping the boss in between the bubbles, and just having the range and melee clumps just in between the bubbles, picking up the buff when you have to, dodging the orbs when you have to. And once I got used to that, I was able to just perform better, really.
Okay, so let's talk mechanically before we go into healing. Mechanically, you found that pretty decent, right?
Yeah.
Did you find yourself taking lots of damage from the orbs?
I did take some damage from the orbs. I knew I probably didn't get behind the blue bubble fast enough to dodge the orbs, so I took a hit of the orbs themselves. You can survive, but maybe I should have done that, but I knew I was able to take a hit of the orbs and live. But if I was out of position, for example, I would just bubble.
Okay. So yeah, I'm looking at your ring damage here. You took, 2.6 million from the rings? Singularities, I know we were soaking singularities for a bunch of them, so we're not going to count that one. Beams, you got hit by 3 beams.
Yeah, I had, I know I was looking at the logs, I was actually targeted by beam, so I got hit.
Okay. Let's take a look here. Divine protection. Where's the divine protection showing up? Awesome, divine protection is not showing up, but I'm seeing it somewhere midway through the encounter. So why? Yeah, looking at Grand Magistrix.
Okay.
Yeah, so you've got one divine protection. What's the cooldown divine protection that you have right now?
1 minute.
Right. So given that it was a how long was it? It was a 2.5 minute fight. Why not one extra divine protection?
Just absentmindedly never pressed it. Really, that's all I can say. There's no excuse for that.
Okay. Well. That's fine, but like, when would be the ideal times to hit divine protection? Like, I'm not trying to
if
shit
I
on him.
If I get hit by an orb, for example.
Okay. And do you remember the timings of the orbs?
Is it every 30, 45 seconds? Around there.
One sec, this is only showing our last phase, I think. Why am I not showing the last ones? One sec. Yeah, I mean, this doesn't make sense that it's only showing it. Because it was a much longer fight than 2.5 minutes for us.
Yeah, I'm seeing. About in about 30 to 36 seconds, there was a hit. And then at a minute 15, if I'm reading that right, on the damage taken. I know the timings were off on LFR and just the fight in general, but...
Okay, so mechanically, you were able to track your speed debuff?
Well, at first, like I said, like, I was the first pull or two, I forgot that the debuff, like, I mean, the speed buff, you okay. Can, like, the healer can keep replenishing it. Because the bubble doesn't go away, so the healers can still keep refreshing the buff constantly. Yep. So I know there were a couple times I let it fall off and forgot for a few seconds.
Okay, and what was your uptime on fast time?
Where is it?
Yeah, these logs. The comparison tool is a little broken right now.
I have a 56% uptime.
Okay, yeah, no, that's right. And that's not bad, given that the expedients aren't up that often. I would say that's a pretty solid uptime for the most part. Okay, the keylogger only captures P3. So I've got wipe number 2. Yeah, that makes a lot more sense. Let's look at wipe number 2. You're 745. That's a much better log. All right. Okay, so I'll go link you the log one more time here. Alright, so this is the uptimes themselves on fast time. So you're 52%, but half the encounter for the most part, you know, you had the buff up, which is pretty decent. And it's obviously not up the entire time. But that's pretty good. So how are you tracking that fast time debuff?
Weak aura.
Okay, you've got a weak aura? Can you share that weak aura with me?
Yeah. It's actually out of a low spreadsheet. Well, we just link the actual spreadsheet itself.
Do you have it loaded in game or no?
No.
Okay, I'll load it one second. Okay, cool. And so you're finding that weak aura is enough to track the buff, you know, pretty well?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Cool. So mechanically, yeah, that was fine. Let's look at damage taken. Yeah, Singularity, you know, we were both scumbags on that fight, you know, in particular. We were, you know, soaking the crap out of them for padding. So we're going to ignore that. But Arcanic Ring, yeah, you took 2.13 mil, I took 2 million... you took 4 hits, I took 5. Why would I have more damage Sorry, less damage with more hits.
You probably pop Divine Protection on one of those hits than me.
Okay. Let's take a look at Divine Protection usage. Divine Protection. Here we go. Now we're getting much better numbers. Well, no, that one's bugged again, of course. But you did hit it 5 times throughout that encounter, which is much better. I mean, you didn't hit it near the end, which I think we were wiping anyway, but you did hit it appropriately. And I just wish these timings would line up with that damage taken. Yeah, it's not showing. What is this log here from Roshi? Yeah. And so this log here, this is actually a better indicator of your actual uptime of the buff the entire time. Yours is 52% there, and you can see, you know, guys like Firemancer, Altaris, Ganor, they did a pretty solid job as well, keeping it active. And if we isolated that time frame, you know, a little bit shorter, because we all just sort of wiped at the end and there was no buff up, you can see, you know, who did a really good job and who, you know, did not did a great job. So even myself there, you know, I let mine drop, I think, the third section there.
Yeah, I let mine drop around, sort of, not really around the time you did, and I noticed I have a big chunk near the middle where I probably just refreshed it instantly.
Okay. Let's look at debuffs again here.
But obviously, on Mythic, we wouldn't have as much uptime as the DPS because they would prioritize the bubble.
Yeah, but depending on how it's going to work on Mythic, whether it's going to shrink or not, and how we're going to prioritize, I mean, keeping uptime is important, partly because of our mana usage as well, right? Like, we don't want to be... Like, if your mana usage is higher, you may be casting more Flash of Lights or whatever, but if your mana usage is lower, well, because of the haste buff, you could probably be casting more Holy Lights. Okay. So, mechanically, found that one okay. Let's take a look at Tichondrius. Alright, so these are our healing logs for Tichondrius. Why is Ziptime so high in melee? Because they better be doing it. Like, they better be... Because of the way we position the boss, we sort of had him in the middle of three orbs. The melee could just dip in and out and keep refreshing their buff, so it was really easy for them to do. Okay, let's take a look at the breakdown here. We'll compare it to itself. So those of you watching on stream can see exactly how we compare reports. Magistrix, let's take a look at Tichondrius. Alright, healing. Let's look at Ashtang on the first one. And Smallwood on the second. Alright, there we go. Okay, so there's your healing breakdown. You got 64 million healed total. So why, firstly, why this talent choice?
Well, let's see. I was running Lightbringer because since there's a melee and range clump, being able to heal the melee and range clump as if I was standing on either stack benefited the mastery, as well as Light of Dawn is good on this fight for the AoE healing we have to do, and Lightbringer also buffs up Light of Dawn, making it a good choice. Bestow of Faith is good because there are targets taking constant sustained damage, be it Carrion Plague or the tanks. So putting that up on those targets is also good.
Did you not find there were times where you could throw down a Lightshammer?
There could have been times, such as when the...
I'm questioning it. Like, Lightshammer is the wrong choice here.
Bloods or boss.
But I want to see that he has a reasoning why he chooses a certain talent. And he's totally right. You know, Bestow Faith is the one you go with, for sure.
Because
it's insane tank damage.
It's a bigger clump to justify the talent choice for the healing.
Okay, cool. Fair enough. That's fine. Keep going.
that Aura of Mercy, it's just its rehealing and the cooldown from Aura Mastery is more beneficial to help kind of top people off if they need it during Touch of the Void or another fight section.
Okay, so that'd be my big question to you. So yeah, Bestow of Faith, fine, Rule of Law, you know, that's also correct because we are in a ranged position. You know, that's going to help with our Light of Dawns and our cooldowns. But Aura of Mercy, so why Aura of Mercy over Devotion Aura?
I remember we talked about this. In an Aura Mastered Devo is point for point better, but the baseline Devo stacked up with range would probably be like 1% DR, maybe less, split between everybody, where Aura of Mercy is just free healing on three targets constantly, and the heals can crit, so it's just overall 3 HPS.
Okay, so how many did we have in that raid? So let's talk numbers. How many did we have in that raid? 5, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 22, 23, 23, 23 people. He knows his shit. That's good. That's very good.
I count 23.
Yeah, so 23 people. Okay, well, next question is, were you always stacked in with all 23 people?
No.
Okay, so then the aura itself would not be drop it down to, you know, the 1%, right? Because it's 20% split between everybody else that is within, you know, your 10-yard radius. So likely people would have had the buff at roughly, you know, 2%, sometimes 3%, again, depending on where you were standing. If you had, for instance, the Carrion Plague and you ran over the Carrion Plague group, well, then your aura is probably doing something like 6% damage reduction on all of those guys, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, why Devotion Aura? Or, sorry, why Aura of Mercy over Devotion Aura? Is that damage reduced not better than the damage healed?
For baseline, I don't know fully. I know that, I mean, you're right in that. If I'm off with Carrying Plague, that's more DR for them. But I don't know if point for point that would outweigh the free healing from Aura of Mercy. I just know that the main reason I took it was for if I needed to pop Aura Mastery and the raid needed healing from my Aura of Mercy over a damage reduction.
Okay. So, I mean, Aura of Mercy, you did pop it once during the encounter. It was a 525 encounter. You popped it. You know, you probably could have popped that at the very, very end when we were all dying for whatever reason. I can't remember when you died on this one. Tally dies.
I never died on this pull.
Yeah, no, you didn't die on this one. No, that's right. Probably could have popped it near the end there, but if you look at the big spike here, which is your actual Aura Mastery healing, I'm leveling as Holy. And for healers, you should be leveling as Holy as well. Okay, so this is your healing with Aura of Mercy, and you can see during that time frame, right? So this is all of your, all of your healing received. One sec. What am I doing? What up here? Okay, so pull up in your logs the healing that Aura of Mercy did. So for those of you just tuning in here, Feverish, we're doing a mock sort of mentor process. We're going through one of our apps, or potential apps, like one of our apps from last week, and we're going through the logs, and we're going through that kind of analysis to see, you know, why he chose certain things, you know, how he did on the last encounters, that kind of stuff.
Okay.
You have a link to it?
Yeah.
Okay, hit me with the link.
That should be it.
Okay. So your Aura of Mercy healed for 854,000. One sec here. So let me go back.
Wait. It says, oh, that's on myself.
Yeah, that's on yourself.
Okay.
Because your Aura of Mercy actually did 5.8 million, right?
Yeah.
So pull up that 5.8 million on your logs. Give me a sec here. Hey, Carathras. Don't you need a bunch of data to get an average? I'm looking for an average. I'm looking at during his Aura Mastery time frame. I mean, just his Aura Mastery healing itself. Alright, so there's your 5.8 million, right? So that's all the people you healed. You healed yourself for 854,000. 5.8 million total. So obviously people that were out of your range, like the melee, were healed for a lot less. And you can see by your log that these guys got a lot more healing, the ones that were in range of you, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. So let's isolate just that Aura Mastery time period. One sec here. 14. Really, we can be just looking at this point here. So there's an example of just during this time period. I mean, Aura Mastery didn't last this long. This is the 16-second limit here, and the log time point timestamp isn't working correctly.
Yeah, I have the same issue too when I pull it up.
Okay. All right. So during Aura Mastery, you healed for 2.4 million, right? Right around there. I mean, it's a 25-second time period, but 2.4 million. Okay, so what damage was going out during that time when you decided to pop your Aura Mastery?
That was during the second Touch of the Void, when I was assigned to use my Aura Mastery. So that damage was going out, and if I popped it too early or too late, I might have gotten some Carrion Plague, healing up some Carrion Plague damage as well.
Okay, so, sorry, did I assign you to the first or second one there?
You assigned me to the second.
Okay, so you were already hit with the second one. Let's take a look at damage taken here. Let's pull up another log. Antichondrius. Where's that damage here? I broke it. Okay, so show me all damage taken just on yourself. Or really, just pull up all damage taken on the actual log itself. Let me pull this up myself here. One sec, guys.
Through the entire fight or that time frame?
Go through the entire fight because it's really easy to isolate the time frame. See, this guy knows his logs well. Knows exactly what's up. Okay, so this is damage taken, right? And so which spell was the one we were, you know, watching for?
Aura Mastery.
Well, no, it was Echoes of the Void, right? Echoes of the Void is...
Oh, yeah, sorry.
Alright. So that's Echoes of the Void damage there. Okay, and so that was, what, 53 million HP over the course of the entire encounter, which shows us that Psycho, Panzer, Zenovian did not do a great job hiding from the pillars, right? And then Tali, Samoran, Eyelid. So it shows you exactly who did a good job hiding from the pillars and who was, you know, really slower out of position and going into them. Okay, so, you know, during Devotion Aura, or let's say during a... Well, let's look at the first one here. The first 32nd, or... Why don't we look at the second one, right? I think the second one is the one where you healed. Okay, so what number did we get for how much you heal during this time?
854,000.
I know that was on yourself, remember? I think it was 2 million.
Oh yeah, 2.3 million.
Okay, so 2.3 million, whereas we took 7 million during this Echoes. During the exact same Echoes, we took 7 million, right? So apply a raid-wide 20% reduction to it. It'll give us a rough number of how much would have been saved. So do the math, 7.1 times 0.8. And that gives us a rough number, which doesn't include any of the other mitigating abilities because it's all multiplicative.
5.68.
Okay.
That's what would.
Okay. So 7.1 minus 5.68 is what? Okay, so if we had chosen Devotion Aura during that encounter on that particular Echoes, what would have been, you know, the better one? So if Aura of Mercy healed 2.4, and then Devotion Aura did how much? Yeah, queries. Yeah,
saved
later on.
2 million damage.
This is the basic stuff. Because with this log, I mean, yes, we could see. I mean, Kuri's got a much better way of showing it, right? You can see exactly how much Aura of Mercy did during this exact section. And when we go through Warcraft logs for your viewers later on, this is sort of the advanced stuff of when you use the query tool, whatever you want to call it, for isolating certain time segments and that kind of stuff. With most players, yeah. I mean, we'll just do it the slow method way so they can sort of see step by step how to go through these things. I guess there could be an argument for, you know, going through these quicker and seeing how much, you know, is being healed. Yeah, totally. Yeah, so 2.9 million. Sorry, give me those numbers one more time.
So 20% of 7.1 million was 5.68, and 7.1 minus 5.68 was 1.42.
Okay, well, I mean, yeah, Aura of Mercy during that section healed for about 3 million, 207 hits during that time period. 3 million, and then really, if we had chosen Devotion Aura during that time frame, well, then it wouldn't have been as effective point for point. If you, you know, if 1 HP mitigated, if you equate that with 1 HP restored, right? So then, Aura of Mercy would have been the better choice. That being said, we had a lot of you know, mitigating cooldowns running as well as heal saturation. People did a really good job dealing with that one.
So maybe if people did a better job with hiding, maybe Devo could have been better, do you think? Or,
I mean, yes and no. So what we did that the other night where we looked at Krosis, right? Where we looked at how much damage was prevented during a smash or during whatever, because Del ran Mercy and I ran Devotion, and then we, you know, we had looked at what would have been better point for point, and Devotion Aura probably would have been better, right? But if you can't heal people up in that time frame, well then, yeah, you know, Mercy might be better in that situation, so we would switch off the auras depending on what kind of situation, what kind of heal comp, you know, positioning, all that other kind of stuff. And so I noticed when we did raids earlier, you ran Devotion Aura. And so why did you run Devotion Aura before and change to Mercy?
From like the interview, I know we talked about Devo and Mercy, and I was just kind of... Maybe I was set in my ways with Devo, I was choosing Devo over Mercy for like a raid setting, but I was just kind of seeing how Mercy compared to Devo, if you can say that.
Okay,
and just,
so...
Just see what happened.
Okay, so, like, why make that guess? This is where I'm going to be a little bit harder on him.
I mean, it's testing. I think testing is a great environment to make these kinds of guesses and see what is better and what isn't, as
okay,
opposed
so,
to...
Right, no, that's fair. What if it was not, I mean, not a beta testing environment? Let's say this was an actual progression raid. You know, why are you choosing one aura over the other? Like, if you say testing, well, you know, are you that mathematician? Are you one of those Paladin theory crafters that are testing different environments? And why didn't you test them in beta?
If it's an actual raid environment on live, I wouldn't do that. I would do what I knew was best, either from, more than likely, from these mathematician theory crafters that did all the number crunching to say what aura is best for what fight. Or, for example, I would ask you, what do you think is best if I was unsure on what to do?
Okay. And that's exactly what I'm looking for, like, you know, where you're going with your choices, you know, whether you're just sort of testing things. Well, then if you're just testing things, you're not, and no offense, you're not that high-end tester that some of these other guys are. The argument, you know, would rather be, like, I'd rather people make the argument of, well, if you got two paladins in the raid, one should probably run Devotion Aura, one should probably run Mercy, right? You shouldn't both run Devotion Aura. That would be my argument, you know, outside of that aura mastery setting, because it's not going to be as effective as Mercy and Devotion itself. But yeah, yep. So my question was, you know, where are you going to get your information from?
I would get it from you. I would get it from Dreamguard or whoever writes the ICBN's guide as well, see what they all say.
Okay, yeah, I mean, you can go to the Paladin Discord, the MoChamp cesspool, and yeah, I mean, you can go through these logs as well and see what these other guys are doing, right? Because, you know, what if what I'm doing is not accurate, right? And that's where I'd want a player to go to me, and even one of my apps to go to me and say, hey, you know, what you're doing may not be effective. You know, don't be afraid of scary Sparty. Just, hey, you know, these are some numbers to back it up. Have you thought of, you know, using this talent or this cooldown or this aura instead?
Yeah, and maybe I should have, since we were both in the raid, maybe I should have ran Evo. Just from what you're saying, I remember I did that a while back. I switched auras with you, but I just wanted to see how Mercy was, but you raised a good point. Maybe I should have ran Evo, but oh well.
Yeah, well, and that's the thing. Like, as an app, right, you check with your mentors, check with the officers what they want you to run, because typically what they want you to run, they may be pretty knowledgeable, unless they're going to say, okay, just run whatever you feel is necessary because we trust you. And that trusting portion comes once you've earned that spot, right? Until then, you know, just run what we tell you to run and then play effectively.
And then also, it would also depend on the raid, like you said, the raid cooldowns available to us.
Yeah, totally.
Like, if we had a bunch of throughput cooldowns, do we need another one? Or we could use a DR cooldown in Devo, for example.
Exactly, right? And then a good example would be something like Ursoc, where, you know, you want that mitigating cooldown, and then you want those throughput cooldowns afterwards as well.
Yep.
Oh, the Canada's cheering yet. Yeah, not how we're doing on the Olympics, though. We're doing not so great. Okay, cool. So let's take a break from logs for a second. How are you, you know, fitting with the guild in general? You know, are you finding there is enough stuff to do? Like, are you making some friends?
Yeah, I've been active and social as much as I can, especially with school being involved at this time. But I've been whatever free time I could spare to devote to WoW, I'm on active, and I found it actually relatively easy to make. Asking guild, hey, if you guys want to run Mythic Dungeons, and I've gotten groups really quickly with the other raiders.
Cool, that's really good. Well, I mean, what else are you doing with your, you know, with your time? Like, yeah, do dungeons? I mean, yeah, in game or outside? You know, are you playing Overwatch with anybody? Like, do you have any interest in Overwatch or Hearthstone or Heroes?
For Blizzard games, I played a little bit of Diablo season when it first came out. Then I was like, oh, I'm done with this. I'm bored. But I also do play Overwatch. In terms of Blizzard games, mostly just Overwatch on the side if I don't feel like doing WoW stuff.
Have you played much with Lucio Ball?
I actually have yet to touch it, to be honest.
I played it. It was pretty fun until just like random people quit or whatever.
Yeah, it's a funny game though. If I'm not grinding out gear or artifact power, I'm typically, like, try to make gold, fish, profession stuff like that.
Okay, cool. At this point in the view, like, we talked about logs, I grinded him a little bit on his questions, and I just want to make sure, well, not an interview, it's a bit of a debrief where, for those of you just joining us now, it's a mentor chat where he's my applicant, I want to make sure he's fitting in, he's having fun with the guild, he's not going to be, you know, just a raid logger, he's what a DG member would be, and we've gone through a lot of logs as well, where's my logs here? We've gone through a bunch of logs as well, and I've asked questioned him, you know, why he did certain things and what he can do to improve. And now, like, I'm going to go back to logs in a second here, where he's going to start critiquing me and tell me what I did wrong, right? And that's sort of what I want him to do. I mean, he's doing well so far, right? Like, he pretty much knows his shit. I questioned some of the things, but I want him to, you know, to continue to build his critical thinking skills, you know, as if I was not here, right? What if Sparty gets hit by a bus tomorrow? Then who's going to hold the paladin up for us? Okay, cool. That just explained to the viewers what was going on. So you played a little bit of Diablo. I don't know. Like, I can't see myself playing Diablo again for another season for 2 weeks and then just quitting it.
Yeah. I feel the same. Just really casual about it, though.
So you said school, right? Like, are you finding school time and raid time to conflict at all? Are you getting, you know, your school shit done?
Yeah, it's my last year of undergrad, working on freaking biology and thesis, and it's a lot of work, but I've been really good at managing my time to get what I need to get done and not letting that interfere with my obligations to Death Jesters.
Okay, cool. Well, that's good. You know that biology is not a real science, right?
Well, it's fine. I mean, everyone else thinks so.
Well, I don't know. You sort of look at chemistry and physics, right?
Well,
the study of energy and the study of matter, and what is biology made out of? Energy and matter. So it's technically a secondary science, not a pure science.
I mean, I'm going to physical therapy school, so I'm not going to be really a biologist. I need the degree.
You're not going to that naturopath garbage, are you?
I'm sorry?
You're not going to that naturopath garbage?
No, I'm not.
Thank God. Okay, that's good. Okay, so let's talk about some other stuff. So with, you know, with your time in school and everything else, Legion prep, how's that coming? Like, have you done a bunch of Legion prep for the encounters? I know you've tested some of them. Which ones have you not tested thus far?
On any difficulty?
Yeah, I mean, just any difficulty here.
I've tested every Nighthold encounter except Gul'dan.
Okay.
I have not tested... Let's see, I've tested Thempia, Ilganoth, Jagir. I very briefly did stuff with Ursox, Cenarius, and Dragons of Nightmare. Those I'm really very fuzzy on. Those are the three I would say I'm the most iffy on in terms of prep, and those are the ones I devote the most time to for prep for Emerald Nightmare.
So Ursox, Cenarius, and was the last Dragons of Nightmare?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's go over some of the encounters. So with Ursox, let's take a look at, you know, just the heroic mechanics themselves, you know, at a very basic level. How is my stuff not working here?
Okay.
Okay, so are there any, you know, healer-specific mechanics that you need to be tracking?
I know I need to make sure if I get, What's that called? Focus Gaze? I know that's a red flag for prepare for lots of raid damage and have something ready for that.
Okay.
And I know that a set group will have to intercept the charge so that the raid takes less, so that everyone takes less damage.
Okay.
For example. And also keep an eye on Roaring Cacophony and how that keeps stacking, because the more that stacks, the more damage his Roaring does, and that's not good. And that's also another red flag for healers. But the fight goes on too long, we can't keep up.
Okay, so yeah, so it's a bit of an enraged mechanic there too with the Echoing Discord, because it does get, you know, unbearably high to heal the longer it takes. So with regards to, you know, the Focused Gaze here, so what do you need to be aware of with that Focused Gaze? Explain to me how that mechanic works.
So when Focused Gaze targets a player, that player has about 6 seconds to just get out as far as possible. And when that 6 seconds is up, he'll charge everyone. He'll charge people in his path, targeting the player. And everyone in his path will take damage and be knocked back, but they also get the debuff, momentum.
Okay.
So they're good, so they take 500% more damage, I believe, from Focus Gaze. And but the actual damage from the charge is reduced by X amount per player hit. So ideally you want two groups cycling, soaking the charges, because if the first group hits twice, more or less they're dead.
Okay. Yeah. So how would our strat, you know, be based around this mechanic?
We would have a set in at least in raid, have a group one and a group two that would, the player that charges out would get out in such a way that the group that the group's turn to soak would be in a good position to get hit by the charge, while the group that is not assigned the hit to soak that charge at that time needs to be nowhere near the radius of Urzok's charge.
Okay, so I'm going to sort of draw you a picture here if you want to follow along on stream of the exact mechanics and the strats and everything else. And just, outside of the tank stuff, outside of the miasma, which we're going to deal with later, but just the charge itself. So if one person gets focused gaze, and let's say it's going to be you, Ash. If you get the charge... So you want to run to, you know, the furthest distance possible because of Trampling Slam. So it's going to hit you for 1.5 million damage, which likely isn't going to kill you, but it's less damage the further you are away from Urzok, right? So you want to get out as quickly as possible. And how would you get out as quickly as possible?
I hope they got a Divine Steed ready.
Yeah, exactly, right? So... you need to be saving your Divine Steed for that specific moment, right? Assume you are going to be targeted every single time by that mechanic and run out. I mean, some players don't have the luxury of Divine Steed, right? But definitely save it for when you are going to get targeted, and assume you're going to get targeted every single potential time. So we have Urzok in the middle. He's a mean bear. What do bears look like? That's a bear. Snout. Okay, so Urzok there, and if you get targeted, so we want to have a bunch of people there.
That is a beautiful drawing, though.
Yeah,
that's a really beautiful drawing.
And so you want to go. So what we're going to do is position the boss in an angular, obviously facing away from the raid, so the melee aren't getting parried. You want to go as far as you can to whatever section. Now, we want to ensure that the entire raid is stacked in. Now, obviously, in this little drawing here, the raid isn't stacked in really well. Yeah, because he has a big, fat-ass body, he's going to trample over everybody else, but ideally, you want people to stack in really well, you know, tight like boys in. This is what I've always said. So, you know, tighter along that line. When you're running out, make sure you run out, because that's going to hit them with momentum. So it's going to do, you know, roughly 500,000 damage to every person. And, of course, if you're running Devotion Aura, it's less than that, and personal mitigation cooldowns, whatever. So it's less than that. So they get it for about 500,000 damage, get knocked back. Now, during this knockback, let's say it was on me and you were in this group. What should you be aware of? Let's say it is a heroic encounter. So heroic Urzok, or, you know, even mythic Urzok. What should you be aware of when you are dealing with the knockback?
I should be aware of my positioning. I should be aware of...
Okay, so why is your positioning... Okay, so why is your positioning important?
Because if I'm for some reason not in that path, that's one less person soaking.
Okay.
And that could, I don't know how much damage it would exactly the raid would gain, but that's still, my job should be to be positioned to soak if I'm assigned to soak.
Right, so the mechanic is there, right? So the mechanic, but let's say you are getting hit by the mechanic. When you are getting knocked back, why is your positioning important? So you are going to get hit by the knockback, but why is that knockback positioning important?
Just to clarify, I'm the one that's targeted? Just to clarify.
No, let's say I'm targeted, and you are standing in the raid, and you are going to get knocked back, right?
Okay.
Because the big-ass man-bear-pig here is going to charge through the raid and knock you back. Why is your knockback positioning important?
On Heroic, there's the... Isn't there, like, these pools that are dropped off whenever he does... what's that mechanic called? I know there's an overlap... Not really overlapping mechanic, but there's something where the boss leaves behind these pools that also leave behind, like, a ghost version of him, and if he roars, that roars too, but
Yeah, that's exactly. Okay. So, yeah, what I was getting to was when you are going to get knocked back, you need to be aware and cognizant of your position because you don't want to get knocked back into a miasma. That is avoidable damage. And that happened to me a couple times when I was doing Heroic Ursoc. You just need to watch your position, so you're either getting knocked back backwards or potentially to the right side if we're on the left side group. Okay? And yeah, so the Barreling Impact, he's going to do, you know, X amount of damage to all players, and that damage is reduced. So Barreling Impact is not directly related to how far he is. Trampling Slam is. So that's, you know, the big clarification there. Not that it's a huge deal. Well, Trampling Slam, that's the one where, you know, it's going to do X amount of damage to you, so you need to get the hell out. Barreling Impact, it's going to do raid-wide damage. So we want to make sure the maximum number of people get hit by that that charge, right? The focus gaze that is on you or me or whatever.
Yeah.
And then the same thing for the opposite side. Right, so if we have people stacked in, right, we want to make sure those guys are getting stacked in as well, so they get the full negation debuff. Now, we did a bit of a leapfrog method. You can take a look at the video later on. Basically, what we did was... it was always the right group being charged. So while we were dragging the boss around because of the miasmas and the echoes, it would always be the right group. So let's say, you know, it's the right group. So we're in group 1 and 3, which is odds, left side. It's groups 2 and 4 going first, and then they're going to get charged. And then they're going to shift in after a couple echoes, because it's two echoes that spawn. Then we are going to be the right side group. So we're going to be leapfrogging and alternating every single time. Does that make sense? Okay. So how many of the miasmas or cacophonies between every charge?
That I don't know.
Okay, it's two, right? Maybe I'm, you know, boring you, but it's two every single time. So you can take a look at the logs as well on Ursoc for when we did it. I think we have logs somewhere. But yeah, so I mean, that's Ursoc in a nutshell. It's a pretty straightforward encounter. It's like Krosis. It's the butcher of, you know, of that specific half tier. Now, in terms of talents, what talents would you run on that encounter?
I don't think Rule of Law would be worth running because they're all so stacked.
Okay, no, I totally agree there.
Thor would depend on the raid comp. I think Devo would be really good for that. Were you running Devo?
Well, let's go tier by tier. Okay, so you want to start with level 30 tier first. So Rule of Law, you're not going to run. Are you going to run Cavalier or UBS?
Assuming that I get picked every time to be charged, I would run Cavalier.
Okay.
Just to have that extra charge. Otherwise, UBS.
Okay, so... let's take a step back. We looked at the strat was probably going to be the leapfrog strat because you are not going to get charged back to back, right? Like, that's not really possible. What is the distance between, or the time difference between charges? Will there be enough time for Divine Seed to be back up again? I'm trying to find my logs here for you guys on stream as well. Where are you, Ursoc?
How often does he cast a run cacophony? Because he said 2 roars per charge.
Right. Well, let's find out. Let me find the log for you. Who am I talking to? I'm talking to a potential app. We're doing a bit of a mock coach's corner, where I am debriefing one of my applicants. They're going through the trial process, making sure they're fitting in well, making sure they're prepped well going into, you know, the next encounters or expansion or whatever. So it's my responsibility as that mentor. So damage taken, we're taking a look at here.
Every 40 seconds for focus gaze?
We can even look at trampling slams here. Because Trampling Slam is the ability, right?
Yep.
Okay, I'm wondering why we're missing one there. Okay, that's better. Well, if you pull up Momentums itself, you can see exactly how often those charges are happening, or how often that debuff is being applied, right?
Yep.
So what, every 25 seconds or so?
I'm looking at, I see 40, or am I wrong?
Okay, so why don't you link me that log? I'll look at something different. Okay, so that log was a trampling slam, and with that one, I don't want to look at it because it is missing one. But take a look at when that trampling slam occurs, right? It's occurring between, 22 and 30 seconds. Mm. Next one happens about 30 seconds later.
Oh, okay, yeah, I see it.
Right, so there's, yeah, I mean, yes-ish 40 seconds. It's a bit of a delay there, depending on how long that person takes to travel, right? Like, depending on how far you take to run. But if you look at momentum itself, that might be a better indicator because we can see exactly, you know, when people are being charged through and how many stacks they took. So in this one, given that it is every other group, so if you're going to be charged on the first group, you're going to be charged on the third group, right? And then fifth group and seventh group. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Because if we're splitting odds and evens, if it's charging on one and three, you know, our group, then we're going to be on group one, and then three, and then five, and then seven. So we had six here. So the time between odds is a good solid minute. So if you have a solid minute between charges, and let's say it does charge, you know, you every single time on one, three, and five, and you need that divine steed. So because it is roughly every minute or so, I mean, the first one is about 25 seconds in, next one is about 1:45 in, and the third one, or the fifth one was roughly 3 minutes in.
Yeah.
So because there's that much time between it, you probably wouldn't choose the Cavalier talent. It's not really necessary.
Yeah, I see that. Okay.
You might use it as an oh shit, where, I mean, you're running out of the miasma or whatever, but then I would say stop standing in shit, right? So then UBS would be the talent to go with, because potentially that second lay hands, great, potentially second bubble, great, and divine protection more often, right? And that's sort of where you want to have that damage reduction, and that's going to help out your healers a lot, so you would go with UBS for sure. Okay, so Bestow Faith, Crusader's Might, or Light's Hammer? What do you want to run on Ursuc?
Light's Hammer would be really good because you can just if
probably
you're
cheated and looked it up.
Like in a stacked clump, you can benefit from a light from Light's Hammer being dropped.
Did you cheat and did you look it up before you answered? It's not an interview. It's just, you know, we're chatting. I want to make sure that he's, you know, a solid player, and I'm constantly challenging him, and he's challenging me. Ash? Uh-oh. I think I've killed him, guys. Bueller? And that was the story of Ashtanga the Applicant. He lasted a couple of raids with us, and then he was no more. He has now disconnected from Mumble. App is done with. Okay, he's disconnected clearly. I'm just joking around here. So what we're doing is, through Coach's Corners, we've gone through how to find guilds, how to apply to guilds, how to write out applications, how to interview for guilds. Ash was my guinea pig. He's one of our subs and Zeros to Heroes raid leaders. He plays a Holy Paladin as well, which is why I sort of pick on him. And he's clearly doing a really good job. Interviewed him last week. We went through a lot of tech stuff and prep stuff and what most mythic guilds would ask at this level. There's some variations of things, but his was a pretty good interview. It wasn't, you know, amazing, but I would say it was a really, really good interview overall. And now this one week is our mock debrief. And what we do, and what some other guilds may do, I'm not sure, is basically we debrief our apps. You know, after every single raid, after whatever happens, we sort of want to see how they did in terms of, you know, well, how did you do on that encounter? Why did you choose these talents? You know, why did you miss your interrupts? You know, what's going on? Do you have all the resources needed Yeah, I know, it still charges. I know, same shit as Clemency. No, I know. There he is, he's back.
That was inconvenient.
Yeah, that's okay. Everyone thought you had, you know, quit your app.
Yeah, that's exactly it.
That's okay. So we were talking about, Ryan UBS on that one. Fist of Justice, Brendan's Blinding Light. On Ursoc?
I don't think it matters. There's no ads, to my knowledge, unless exactly. There's ads.
Yeah, no, that's just, it's whatever. You don't really give a shit on that one. Okay, are you running Beacon of Faith, Beacon of Lightbringer, or Beacon of Virtue on this one?
I would say either Faith or Lightbringer. Even though we're all stacked up for Lightbringer's Mastery, Faith would be good for the tanks, because I know they have to juggle 2 debuffs.
Okay, no, that's a fair point.
I don't know 100% if they're both taking consistent damage to warrant Faith, but Lightbringer would be good to default to just because you also get a buffed up Light of Dawn, and that's good for being stacked up.
Okay. So, let's say you are the only Holy Paladin in the guild. What would you want to run? What would be your go-to right now?
Between those beacons?
Yeah, or Virtue. You know, what would you choose?
I would choose Lightbringer.
Okay, and why?
Because it allows you to be a little more flexible with where you can stand, because you have two technical stat points. Well, you can put a beacon in melee, go out to your range if you have to, and you can also subsequently benefit from a stronger Light of Dawn, which is also really good.
Yeah, he's got it there. Actually
doesn't totally suck anymore.
Okay.
Virtue is... I can't see it in every environment right now. In a dungeon environment, yes. Raid, no. Personally.
Yeah, there's actually a couple bosses where Beacon of Virtue might be useful.
Having at least one beacon up at all times than having a cooldown.
So with Beacon of Lightbringer, you mentioned that on Ursoc you could choose to be a melee or range.
Oh, for Ursoc? I mean, you're...
Yeah, for Ursoc. Anyway. Yeah, so you're always stacked in. So the reason it would have the advantage is that Light of Dawn buff, which is great. As well as when the other group gets hit by their momentum, you can also hit them because of the additional range, right? So it's 30% more range and healing on your Light of Dawn. So when you're directing your Light of Dawn at the other group, it's going to hit them for sure. That's what would be the ideal one. Now, Beacon of Faith, it's a lot more effective if tanks are taking consistent damage the entire time, right?
Yep.
Yeah, pull my logs here.
And if they're not on Ursoc, then you're better off going Lightbringer.
Okay.
Or just in general.
So that's our damage breakdown, or the tank's damage breakdown, damage taken throughout the entire encounter. It is, for the most part somewhat consistent, but they are, constantly switching. You can see a lot of peaks and valleys in terms of how much damage they take, but for the most part they are alternating, right? Like, it is alternating damage, so the argument could be made, if one tank's taking a lot of damage, well, then you just keep the beacon on them, right? You don't need to heal the other guy that much.
Yeah.
Okay, so between Dead Man, so you've got a DK tank and you've got a Guardian tank, which one would you ideally beacon?
The Guardian.
Okay, and why the Guardian?
Because they, the DK can self-heal like mad, and the Guardian, I believe their mastery affects all heals, not just their frenzied regen self-healing. So you can put the beacon on the Guardian, and since it's DK more spiky, heal him and the Guardian will benefit as well. Because assuming the mastery affects all healing, that they also get buffed up healing from your beacon.
Okay.
Is that correct?
Yeah, you sort of lost me.
Okay.
So, yes and no. You want to take the one that you can either snipe heals from, which would be the DK, or the one taking consistent damage, which was the Guardian. Me specifically, I chose to alter my beacons pretty consistently on that encounter, whereas Del kept it on the Death Knight for the majority of the time. Because Death Knights are spikier healers, that adds a little bit of extra cushion for when he takes those big spikes and then heals himself back up, right? So your beacon's going to be more effective on that style of tank. Okay? Okay. And then, okay, what about the other talents? Would you run Holy Prism, Sanctified Wrath? What would be your choice there?
Are you talking about the role of Holy Prism?
Between that? Yeah. So, either Holy Prism or Holy Avenger, you're probably not going to use Divine Purpose, right? And then Sanctified Wrath or Judgment of Light. So, why Holy Prism on that encounter?
Because you can use it, because a good time to use it would just be when he charges and then when people get knocked back, they took damage. So, you just pop a Holy Prism that will heal a couple people up. Holy Avenger is I don't see a benefit on that fight. And as for the 90 row, Sanctified Wrath hands down. Because that's just it's a longer personal healing cooldown and more Holy Shocks.
Okay. And so why not Judgment of Light on that encounter?
Personally, I've not seen Judgment of Light. I know the Icy Veins guy recommends Judgment of Light, but I haven't seen that much of a use for it. For Ursoc,
either of us run devotion. I ran light on that one, right?
I don't think it'd be useful comparison. Because, like I said, I've never seen a situation where Judgment of Light would trump Sanctified Wrath.
Okay, no, that's fine. That's fair. You know, I get the arguments, for and against it. We talk about Aura of Mercy and Devotion again, and I know we looked at damage breakdowns. On this one, we looked at Aura of Mercy and Devotion comparisons. I'd likely go with Devotion Aura. With this one, we obviously had two different paladins, so it didn't make sense to run Devotion. So we ran Devotion and Mercy. That was Del's go-to on that one. And in this log here... One second. And so you can see the damage difference, or the healing difference, with what we did. There's that log. And now his Orb of Mercy did 12.5 million more, which pretty much makes up for that gap of, the lack of healing from me, right? Like 12 extra million healing?
Yeah.
Are you finding yourself using Light of the Martyr much right now?
Only if I have to heal and move.
Okay, so if you're healing and moving, what's your go-to? What's your ideal?
If I have to actually, if I know someone needs a heal and I have to move for whatever reason, I would go to Light of the Martyr or Holy Shock, if Holy Shock is off cooldown.
Okay, and so what about Light of Dawn?
If it's more than one person, then yeah, I would use Light of Dawn as well. But I have to make sure they aim it properly.
Okay, so that's my next thing. So how are you effectively using your Light of Dawn? Are you finding, do you have anything to track it? How many targets you're hitting?
I need to get a weak aura to track Light of Dawn more effectively, because, for example, back when we were talking about Nighthold logs, I noticed you did 4 million more healing on Light of Dawn than I did.
Yep.
And you had 4 more casts than me, so... You just were better at using it than me, because we had the same artifact traits, same everything. So all that is you had a better effectiveness than I did. So I need a more effective way to track it. So a weak aura that says how many people will get hit, for example, would be very beneficial to help my Light of Dawn usage.
Okay, so you don't have one right now?
Not right now.
Okay, so I'm gonna share one with you. So you need this weak aura as well as this add-on. And then I want you to test. Let's just join a group with you with me. Give me one sec. We're gonna set this up together. And this is the mentoring process of an app, right? Like these guys here. I don't know who I banned from the stream, but these guys. I mean, you don't come out amazing players out of your mom's vaginas. It takes time, and you look at other good players for advice to become better yourselves. So I'm not shitting on him. I'm like, oh, you're an idiot for not having these add-ons, these weak auras, all that other kind of stuff. I'm giving him the tools to succeed because I want him to succeed. So have that, or import that weak aura really quick. And then, Okay, so we got that imported. I'm going to give you one more thing to download. It's that link there. Okay, so download that, install it, and then restart your game. And then just come over here. It won't work initially. You need both the add-on as well as the weak core. It's going to give you a range router. You can turn that one off.
Okay.
Where's my little command here? Interface, add-ons. You know what? I actually don't have the add-on installed either. Awkward. I had it on installed in beta, but apparently I don't have it on here for some reason. Alright, that's why I don't have it on. Well, yeah, I had issues with my add-ons. Let's try reloading.
Is this like Canada? It's Christmas every day? Or
do you just have that long
ago Christmas? Yeah.
Yeah, it's Christmas every day. I give out bannings and beatings for Christmas presents. Alright, rip this guy's important gold.
Who's here? This isn't Canada.
Yeah, whatever. Did you get that thing installed or not?
Yeah, I'm doing it right now.
Okay. So what you guys are going to see here, and like the tool that I'm giving him, is basically this. It's a Light of Dawn, and this works for other healing spells as well. How many people are going to get hit by your spell? So right now I've only got it loaded in combat, so I'm going to hit one person with my Light of Dawn. If I face the other way here, I'm going to hit... It'll change to a 2. 2 people are going to hit by my Light of Dawn, myself and this other target.
Okay, start my game.
Okay. Let's see if anybody else is free. Anyone else free for a sec? Let's see if I can get these guys in here as well. Yeah, Little Mo, I'll give you guys... just hold your questions for a sec here. Hold them for a sec. When you look at logs, how concerned are you with rankings on fights for DPS? Only slightly concerned, but then they're just like right now that they're the sticker price, right? But you look at what's under the hood, why they're doing so well or why they're doing so poorly. For instance, Zaykath, my hunters on Siegecraft or Blackfuse, they would never, ever, ever rank. Never. Their ranks were terrible. That mean they were bad players? No. I always put my hunters on Siegecraft or Blackfuse on the belts. So they were doing minimal damage, but they were doing really important jobs. And unfortunately, those kinds of, the importance of the mechanics, the bitch duties, which are more valuable than DPS or healing, they don't show up on rankings. So do we take some stock or credence into rankings? Yeah, a little bit, but not a ton. So, same thing with healing. Healing, even less. Less effective than actual DPS rankings or HPS numbers themselves. Okay, short film. Oops. Ariana's here.
Is that there? Is that that range radar, is that our mastery effectiveness?
Yeah, you can change the mastery effectiveness. I think by default it's set to 20 yards, so anybody within that range radar is going to be hit by, I think 75% effectiveness of the mastery.
Oh, cool.
There's Ariana. Okay, she's going to help us out. So once these guys get over here and you get locked back in. Thanks, Michael. Michael, you just keep moderating the Twitch chat. Okay, so you see the range radar and how it works?
Yeah.
Okay, so you can see, I think mine might actually be set to... Yeah, mine's actually set to 10 yards. Even 8 yards? I think it's 10 yards here for maximum effectiveness. Okay, it should be working. It might just be set to combat only.
Yeah, so
target hit a training dummy, and then you'll see that number of people you're going to hit with that Light of Dawn. So then just twist around, right? You can just move yourself around, and you'll see that number increase or decrease, and obviously try to get your maximum effectiveness, your 5-plus people with that that weak aura.
this is really handy.
And so this way, your Light of Dawns will not be, you know, as wasted. So what encounter was it that I mentioned your Light of Dawn usage?
It was... I think it was Tyke.
Maybe it was Tychondris, yes. Maybe it was, that's what it was. But yeah, I mean, you want to maximize effectiveness of Light of Dawn because it's free heals, right? There's no point to you, you know, facing, you know, a corner here and healing nobody but yourself with Light of Dawn because it's a giant waste. So, you know, use that now more effectively. The range radar, it's up to you. I don't really use it, so you can turn it off.
Band-aid. Do I just turn it off in the add-on settings? Or is that part of the weak aura?
It's part of the actual add-on. One sec here. If you go to interface and add-ons, you can actually enable disable the radar, and you can choose the range of the radar. So if it's set at 20 yards, it's 10 yards all the way away from you, right? All the way around. Zerk, thanks for subbing, man. Cheers. Much appreciated.
Yeah, I have the old Weak Aura still. Really nice Weak Aura.
Yeah, mine's set to 20. So you'll know exactly who is, you know, is a 20-yard radius of that green circle, right?
Yeah.
Or diameter? Yes, diameter, 20-yard diameter. And 10 yards is the radius, right? So, you know, 10 yards maximum effectiveness. And you can make it bigger, smaller, whatever. Player textures, you play around with that. I often play, like, I often just don't use it. I'll typically eyeball things pretty well. Well, 20 yards is across, right?
It's just nice to have if you really need it.
Yeah, no, for sure. I mean, it's going to make your healing that much better. And then you can obviously choose, I think my weak aura, yeah, my weak aura right now is set to in combat only, but you can change it to, you know, always. Let me change mine here really quick. Right, so then if you just change it to load always, you can sort of see how your position is going to affect that Light of Dawn. And if you're playing any other healers, same thing, it's going to be pretty effective, whether it's a priest or whatever else.
Definitely.
Okay, cool, makes sense. So yeah. From now on, you know, use some kind of Light of Dawn tracker, and that'll make your healing that much more effective.
Oh yeah. Thank you.
Okay, cool. So any other encounters you sort of have any difficulties with, challenges with?
Probably the only thing I did in scenarios was a quick LFR, and even then I wasn't fully following what was going on.
Okay.
Mechanically.
Okay, so Scenarios is a really complex one. We can go over a couple mechanics with that one.
Okay.
Okay, so I'm not going to spell it out for him. Yeah, I'm not going to spell it out for you, you know, what to do. What questions do you have about the mechanics on that encounter in general, from what you've seen? So my expectation is he's prepped enough. He's sort of ready to go.
I know
if he has questions, I'm here to clarify.
Cleanse certain allies of nature.
Okay, yeah.
Is there a specific priority on those? Or are do they just come out and you just cleanse them?
So depending on which wave it is, it's depending on what you want to deal with. Typically, you don't want to deal with wisps because they're a giant bitch. You know, there are these wisps that spawn all around the room, and they converge and fixate on players, and then they scrim over. So when you cleanse the wisps will not spawn, right? Whenever you're dealing with any kind of mechanics, you want to deal with, you know, the most deadly to least deadly. And same thing with adds or whenever we're killing, right? When there's stuff that DPS is supposed to kill, we kill the deadliest, which would be the wisps, or the most annoying, to the least deadliest, which would then be the dragons and the sylvan things. What are they called?
The giants?
The Twisted Sisters.
Yeah,
we have the Ancients, the Drakes, the Sisters. Those ones are typically easier to deal with, right, in terms of cleansing, you know, that kind of stuff. So what exactly are your concerns with this encounter?
I think it's more...
It has three versions?
Well, the cleansing is a priority, but I think I'm more concerned with
how... Oh, thanks, dude. Do you have a link to it, Karu?
Just general positioning and what to what is the most immediate kind of threat to the raid that I need to keep an eye on to make sure it doesn't really screw us.
Okay.
Because it just, there's a lot. I know there's videos. I haven't seen one from them.
There's a lot on that encounter. So the first thing with the cleanse, right, you'll have different stack points, or there's different stack points marked on our strat. That's where you're going to be standing to cleanse, right? The more people that are stacked in on that particular spot, that's what's going to cleanse or control which one of the things we are cleansing. I wish I had a video here ready to go from Scenarios for you. Can I paste links to it? Okay, perfect. Thanks.
That's fine. I can do more research on my own time. I just want to
get
a very basic understanding right now of the fight.
Yeah, the big stuff is that the thorns that Scenarios throws up, right? He has an Aura of Dread thorns, and on Heroic and whatever else, it's 30 yards. The big thing you need to realize with that is the DPS that you're playing with sometimes are dumbasses, and they don't realize that they have to slow down or stop DPS because they're just hitting everything really, really quickly, and it's reflecting back on on whatever. They just have to watch what they're doing. So that's probably a tank positioning issue as well. So if you see that the aura is up, well, just watch those melee that are getting hit by it and just getting gibbed. With Nightmare Brambles, we had issues with it targeting. We didn't see an exact arrow, similar to what's the boss? Shadow Lord Discard. You know how there's the fire running around and whatever. So we didn't have that many. I mean, we had an issue where we weren't able to see who it was chasing. So what you can do, this is actually an encounter where you would use freedom pretty liberally. You hit your freedom and you run over the brambles that have spawned, and you get rid of them that way.
Okay,
so if you get hit by it, you're going to get rooted. You don't want to get hit by it. You can cleanse yourself, freedom yourself, whatever, and then run over the other ones. But you will take damage from when you are cleansing those brambles off.
So it'd be good to have a bop, another bop, a DP ready for yourself.
Yeah, DP ready for yourself, and then obviously your freedom as well.
Yeah.
Which one? So with the Rod and Breath here that the Drake throws up, it just chooses a random enemy. So whichever way the Drake is positioned, obviously away from the raid, but he will choose a random person. When you're dealing with this encounter, you want to make sure you're positioned in such a way that will ideally not hit you, and obviously if the breath is on, you just shift away from it. Divine Steed with freedom and Divine Protection might also be a good thing to do for the brambles. Again, depending on how much damage you're going to be taking. Reflect. Worst one. And then the Twisted Sisters will throw their javelins, so it's more debuffs, more things to watch out for. You will see them throw their javelins out.
Okay.
Okay. It's really... We have it on our strat forms. I don't know if you have access to it, as a Zeus to hero.
I do. I was able to see strat stuff for like other bosses, so I would assume I have strat. I'm going to see right now.
Okay. So yeah. With that one, it's partly an enrage check, but it's control, right? Controlling the adds and going back and forth and dealing with all those mechanics. It is a bit of chaos throughout the encounter, and I'll try to pull up a video here if I can. Or maybe, can one of my mods... You have a video?
Oh no, that's the strat sheet from the forums.
One sec here.
I don't have a video.
Yeah, I'll see if one of my mods can pull up the video, and I would go through it step by step with you exactly what's going on. And that's something you should take a look at prior to actually doing Scenarios. Because I know when I do these encounters, I explain step by step what's going on and why we're doing certain things, and where the boss is tanked in certain places. But again, I'll have that video up again, or those guide videos prior to Emerald Ember coming out. It's cleanse the right stuff, make sure you're standing in the right spot, spread out as needed, because there is there's one ability that just blows up on us. I don't remember what it is. Her javelin is one. The touch of life is interruptible, not that we have interrupts anymore.
Hey, we can taunt him. It's fine. Useful.
And then Scorn Touch is another one we have to watch out for. But I mean, Scenarios is just one that you need to get a little bit of experience with, just to see how much chaos is going on. But really follow the markers, right? Follow the orange marker, which is me, and then you typically won't go wrong, you know, in terms of positioning.
Okay.
Okay, cool. Yep. So do you have any other log questions, any talent questions? It's my Mandar Pig.
What other fights do you think Lighthammer would be a good choice on?
Question. Let's take a look here. Nathendra... Yeah, I don't think Nathendra would be that effective. Probably go with Bestow Faith. Illagoth, again, potentially depending on your positioning. Probably not for Mythic. Normal and Heroic, you potentially could get away with it. Not that there's crazy amounts of damage. I mean, typically you're spread out anyway on Illagoth. Renferal potentially as well, but I see from my experience tank damage has been a lot higher with that one. Ursoc, I think you would definitely want to run it. You can run cooldowns and that kind of stuff. If tanks are doing their job, you should not have issues with, you know, you shouldn't need Bestow Faith. I think the Light's Hammer in conjunction with Devotioner will be a lot more effective. Dragons of Nightmare, you definitely would not run Light's Hammer on that one. Scenarios, potentially. I think the tank damage was quite high, though, so you would probably not run it there. Xavius, there are plenty of stack points, but there is not a lot of just raid-wide damage or constant raid-wide damage that would warrant Light's Hammer. I would definitely go with Bestow Faith, I think, on that one. I have to look at my logs again. With Nighthold, Scorpion, you could totally run Light's Hammer on Scorpion. Or Bestow Faith, depending on what's necessary. I know when I switched away from Bestow Faith on one encounter, the tank died, but, you know, it's just anecdotal. What else here? Ticondra's probably not.
Trilliax, I don't think so.
Chromatic Anomaly, definitely not.
Spellblade, no, not. Maybe, no.
Yeah, Trilliax definitely wouldn't, because there's too much movement involved in that one for Lightshammer to be that effective. And the tank damage is quite high anyway.
Maybe Krosis? Would be good after a slam?
Yeah, totally. Lightshammer on Krosis is definitely a good choice. The tank damage is not that bad on normal, heroic, whatever. And it's that extra throughput cooldown that you need. What else? Grand Magistrix, also you would not run Lightshammer there, again, just straight up tank damage, because, again, the rate is spread out, you're dealing with the singularities, you're you know, you're baiting them effectively. So, yeah.
I think we'll die, we don't know.
Excuse me. Yeah, exactly, we don't know cooldown, right? I mean, we'll see. Cool. So, yeah, I mean, that's sort of it for our chat. I know it was a bit of a longer chat here. A good solid hour and a half chat with this debrief, but we just want to make sure, you know, you're doing well, you're fully prepped, you sort of know your shit, and you're using the right resources. So, you know, if you have a question about a certain talent or choice or whatever, you're not going to Noxic. You know, you're going to either a good paladin, or you're going to a better resource, you're going to, you know, one of the good holy paladin guides that are there. Okay, and in terms of prep, you know, obviously, you know, you're doing a decent amount of prep. I'd love everybody to, you know, be raid leader prepped, you know, like myself and Bran and some of the other guys, because that would make our job so much easier. But really, your goal, again, is, again, mechanics number one. You know, who your heals and your HPS should always be second. So mechanics always, always, always first. And make sure you have the right talents, you know, set up to make sure those mechanics happen. And yeah, and that's it for the most part, right? So you just gotta, you know, keep pushing. You know, your goal here is to be the best holy paladin, you know, on the server. So make sure you're putting an effort to make that happen. That's your goal, right? Your goal is to outperform me consistently every single time. And, you know, the last paladin that was, you know, in your position that did become a member did exactly that. You know, they surpassed me, you know, they were kicking my ass every which way.
Sounds good.
Sounds good? Okay. And yeah, I mean, we can sort of just wind down from there. But yeah, if you have any more questions, you know, go to myself or the other mentors, or talk to one of the officers, or any of the vets if you have questions about the other kind of stuff. But otherwise, you know, keep being social in the guild. We want to make sure, you know, you're playing with the other players and not just, you know, sort of doing your own thing. Because again, you're not just in a raiding guild here. You're more part of a community. You're here to make friends and not just, you know, top the healing meters and kill bosses and that kind of stuff. That's not exactly, you know, what we're interested in. We're interested in a lot more than that. Okay, sounds good?
Sounds good. Thank you.
Awesome. Well, thanks a lot.